Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Long as my heart beating and I'm breathing air, I fight for me, what a sight, anytime, anywhere. And I will never back down from it. That's not coming, I just attack from the front. And don't ask questions or nothing, do you hear? Yeah. Yeah. Oh no, I can't stop now. I gave it my all and it still ain't enough. Everybody getting knocked down. The only thing that matters, what you gonna do when you get up? Get up there. Ain't no matter what you gon' do when you get up. Ain't no matter what you gon' do when you get up. Get up. Get up. Ain't no matter what you gon' do.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God.
Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. My heart beating and I'm breathing air, I fight for me, what a sight, anytime, anywhere. And I will never back down from it. That's not coming, I just attack from the front. And don't ask questions or nothing, do you hear? Yeah. Yeah. Oh no, I can't stop now. I gave it my all and it still ain't enough. Everybody getting knocked down. The only thing that matters, what you gon' do when you get up? Get up there. Ain't no matter what you gon' do when you get up. Ain't no matter what you gon' do when you get up. Get up. Get up. Ain't no matter what you gon' do.
Thank you.
I love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness. I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Long as my heart beating and I'm breathing air, I fight for me, what a sight, anytime, anywhere. And I will never back down from it. That's not coming, I just attack from the front. And don't ask questions or nothing, do you hear? Yeah. Yeah. Oh no, I can't stop now. I gave him my all and it still ain't enough. Everybody getting knocked down. The only thing that matters what you gonna do when you get up. Get up there. Ain't no matter what you gon' do when you get up. Don't no matter what you gon' do when you get up. Get up. Get up. Don't no matter what get up.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. love you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness.
Yes.
Would you bow with me in prayer, please? Most holy and heavenly and reverend Father, we, your humble servants, we come into your presence this day to celebrate the life of our brother who has departed, whom you have called from this life to be with you. Father, we pray, O God, that you will give the family strength as they mourn the loss, but celebrate his life. We are thankful, O Lord, for all that you have done for us and for all who have gathered this evening in support. We also ask blessing upon them as we consider even our faith. So we ask, O God, at this time, as we go through this ceremony, that your Holy Spirit will be upon us and that all we will do will be decently done in order and according to your will. In Jesus' name, with thanksgiving, let the church say, amen. Please have your seat. I'm not too sure. Okay. So I hope my voice is loud enough that everybody is hearing me. Are you hearing me in the back? Right. So then between, obviously, will hear me by God's grace. Right. So first of all, we want to offer our sincere condolences to the bereaved family. We want to actually offer our, you know, empathy to Nisa Williams, the wife of the deceased, and to the family, his mom and dad and siblings who are here. It's a fate that we all not familiar with, we don't like, but it's something that all of us have to prepare one day to deal with. And so I just want to offer a few words of not just advice, but empathy to all present. We are here today, and a question that Kerry will be saying to us, that he has traveled a road, and are we ready or preparing to travel that road? Unfortunately, that road called death is not done because you are ill. There's no real way to prepare, if I want to put it that way. Some people born, and as they born, they're going back. So it doesn't go with age. There are people who die healthy, but they're gone anyway. And as I was saying, my mom was one of them, gone healthy. She died, nothing was wrong with her. Doctor said, just bury her, no post-mortem. So there's no rules. It doesn't go by age, doesn't go by youth, but it is one of the things you certainly can prepare for. Because of how grievous it is a subject we don't like to talk about, but it is inevitable. All right, now, I would like to point out this fact that we don't make much time to sit down and talk about it. But it's moments like these cause all of us to reflect on where did we come from, what are we doing here, and then where are we going? We are faced with the stark reality that that is the fate of humankind. But it didn't start there. I want you to know that we are not simply lumps of clay. We are more than that. What we're going to commit to the earth today is our brother remains, but that's not him. You see, we are made in the image and likeness of our Creator. And his likeness is not dirt. God is a spirit, and they who worship him, that's why you must worship him in spirit and in truth. Because he's not made from clay. But if we are making his image, the question is, what image then are we? Well, there's something inside of us that is precious to Almighty God. It's called our soul. You can't see it, smell it, taste it, or touch it, but you better believe it's there. Because when it leaves you, that's why we are here this afternoon. Because our brother spirit has departed and gone back to his Creator. Now, one of the quality of God is that he is eternal from everlasting to everlasting. What means then, we are also like that, but not in the flesh. Now God, when he created the first two people, Adam and Eve, they run the test for the whole human race. And the choice wasn't the best choice. God did tell them, he did tell them, the day that you disobey, you will die. The day you disobey, you will die. You may reflect and say, but wait, the day that Adam and Eve sinned, they didn't die. Oh yes, they did. You see, the word death means separation. And God immediately put them out of the Garden of Eden from his presence. So death just means separation. They were separated from the source of eternal life. We wasn't made to die, but it's the consequence of sin. Now, it's something I don't like and I wish I didn't have, but you have too. I don't like the power that God gave me of choice, but I have it. And therefore, you know, when we make computers, this is a computer, a phone, this phone can only do what it's programmed to do. If it does something besides that, even if it's a good thing, it's malfunctioning. See, it has to operate according to how it was designed. But God gave us a power of choice. Now, hear what we do with that power. We don't like responsibility for ill. You know, that's why we like to blame somebody else. So when Adam and Eve sinned and God came to them, Eve blamed the serpent. And Adam blamed God. Oh, what's it funny? No, Adam said, the woman you gave me, give me to eat. In other words, I was here good all the time. And Satan couldn't get you to me and I didn't sin. But the woman you give me and I eat, so it's your fault. But so what we find from the beginning is people don't like to take responsibility. They always try to find an excuse to shift the buck. But it had none of that in this life. There's nobody sitting here and I standing and who's standing in the back who have done anything that is anybody else's fault. You all look at what's making kind of funny, but it's truth. You see, if I put a gun to your head now and tell you, if you don't do what I say, I will shoot you, you have a choice. A hard one, but a choice. Do your own thing and live, and die, or do what I say and live. If you choose to do the wrong thing, you can't say you didn't have a choice. You had a choice to die. You choose not to die. And so this morning, or this evening, a lot of us here, as I say, standing, you sitting, are blaming everybody for what's going on in your life except yourself. But one day, all of us is going to stand before our Creator. He's not going to ask husband about wife's jurisdiction. And he's not going to ask wife about husband. He's going to ask you about your jurisdiction. So nobody to say, well, I did this because I'm going to he just now. Tell me about you. Why didn't you do what you're supposed to do? Or when it get hard, it's called no choice. When it get hard, it's still a choice. We have to live out our lives before God in righteousness. Because there is a penalty to pay for living reckless and sinful. Father will not pay for children, and children will not pay for father. Now we like to talk about generational curse, but God said to the prophet Ezekiel that the soul that sin, it shall die. That change. He says, so if the father eats sour grape, his teeth will the son teeth will edge him. And if the son eats sour grape, the father teeth will edge him. But you who sin, you are the answer for you. So one day, God said in the book of Timothy that we all shall stand before the judgment seat of God to give an account of what we did in the flesh, whether it be good or evil. So on judgment day, Mr. Bill Clinton will be there. Mr. Biden will be there. Kim Jong-un will be there. Dr. Rowley will be there. Ms. Cameron will be there. And the vagrant downtown will be there. And you and I will be there. And see if all the excuses we're making now for not doing right, if it will stand before Almighty God. Kerry is already gone on. And he going on is saying to us who remain, prepare to meet your God. Because we're going to meet him. Look what's happening. Because we're not learning to be like God, we come out of the COVID into the war going on in Russia with the Ukraine. And just the other day, this one had the potential to turn into a third world war. That's going on now in that Gaza area. Oh yes, has the potential. But I know what problem. You know the problem is? You have to live until God call you. And you'll have to give an account for what you do. So, if Corey looking over us now could say anything, he would say, are you preparing to come home? Because here is no home. The people who will not trust God, you know what they're doing? They're building bigger rockets and trying to go further out in space to see if they can find God. But either way, they're going to find him. You'll find him in righteousness. Because he is in us, because we are made in his image and likeness. We have a spirit that is given after God, but he gave us the power to choose how to use it. All right? Now, I want to just share with you a story found in the book of Luke, chapter 16, that talks about many of you will be familiar with Lazarus and the rich man. All right? Lazarus was a beggar, and he used to lie by the rich man gate. And he was so desperate, all he wanted was the, you know, like when we go and buy a little KFC and Royal Castle and thing, you know, we posh, right? We eating a little piece of the wing and thing, right? You know, that too, dying for we, dying of we standard. So we leave that in the box. And we are biting up the bone and thing. All Lazarus wanted was the scraps remain to stay alive. And the rich man will pass there every day and pay no heed to him. He lived reckless, he had a ball, he had money. Drive, well, back then he had a car, but if we bring it into modern times, he driving the best car, the biggest house, you understand, all the gold, all the ring, nice life. But this life came and passed, and it says that Lazarus died, and the rich man died. And on the next side is called eternity. You see, when you're dead, you ain't done, you know. Death is not the cessation of your existence. It's the beginning of eternity. When you leave here, death is no more. You'll live forever. But the question is where? Every single one of us is going to live forever. But you have to determine where. You can't live reckless with hate and despite and neighbors and talking to one another and all kind of thing and feel you're going to stand in the presence of God and everything will be okay. If you ain't fix it here, it just ain't going to fix. Death is a doorway that there's no return from. And the only person who could call you back from there is the Creator. That's why the only person I know called back people from the dead was Jesus. Because John tells us everything was made by him. Father gave him that power and for him. So that's why he could have called back Lazarus from the dead. That's why he could have wake up the young girl and the son of the soldier, because he has power over life and death. So you could choose whatever you want now. Live it however you want now. But be sure you're going to die. Your only hope of not dying is if the last trumpet song, then it says the dead in Christ will rise first. And we who are alive, that live according to the will of God, will be caught up to meet him in the air, to be with him forevermore. And judgment of the unrighteous is going to take place. I, not here this evening to judge nobody. Because if you judge yourself on judgment day, you wouldn't be judged. Because you know what is right and wrong, and you have to choose to do it. But guess what? The wrong thing is very easy to do. The easiest way to not do the right thing is to do nothing. And that ain't hard. But if you want to make heaven your home, it'll cost you something. It will cost you loving people who are very unlovable. That is what God did. He's on the cross dying and he said, Father, forgive them. They know what they're doing. Somebody busting your head and you won't forgive them. You won't bust back the head. But that is not God's way. God's way is to forgive. Stephen has been stoned to death. And he said, do not lay this charge against them. Why? Because they could kill my body. But God could kill your body and soul in hell. And that is where you're breaking from. You know, plenty of people don't understand. When you say to people, repent and be baptized and you shall be saved. You're not going to be saved from COVID. You're not going to be saved from cancer. You're not going to be saved from bandit breaking in your house tonight. That's not what they're talking about. You see, that soul that you have is precious to Almighty God. And only He will judge you and determine where you're going. You're not going to be saved from even this death. But let me read for you what the Revelator said, John said, in the book of Revelation. So if you're here and you have your Bible and your phone, as the case might be, you could join me there and read. Hear what he's talking about, say, from. So I could move a little bit, get a little closer, because my mouth is the mic. Right. Hear what he says. And we all will face this. Don't worry, I ain't taking long. In verse 11, Revelation 20, verse 11, he said, I saw a great white throne and him that sat upon it, from whose face the whole earth fled, and there was no place found for them. God is so awesome to be in front. He said, and I saw the dead. Which dead? Small and great stand before God. And the books, I'm stressing the S, were open. The Bible has 66 books in it. 39 in the old, 27 in the new. And therein, Paul tells us that all things that pertain to life and godliness is written there. Anything you want to do to please God is written there. And you can find out if you make the time. If you make the time. He says the books is open. And another book, singular, was open. Which is the book of life. Right now, again, you sitting and standing. You are either writing your name in the book of life or taking it out. But it's your choice. Nobody fault but yours if you end up on the wrong side on judgment day. Nobody fault but yours. You ought to think about what you're doing to be pleasing God or not. He says, and the dead was judged out of the things written in the books. Now, I hope some of you all follow me on your tablet, whatever, you know, because anyway, you feel is Brother Alexis saying this, you know. I want you to know this is from God's holy and righteous word. So I ain't judging you. He says, according to their works, everything we are doing is record. If man could take tape and record everything we're doing, if as we're talking here, satellite is picking up that and the whole world could be watching this funeral, you think it's a big thing for God to roll back your life from birth to death? And every excuse you make, he roll it out and show you. It's not hard at all. If we could do it, we could understand God can do it. It says, and the sea give up the dead in them, and death and the grave deliver up all the dead which were in them, and they were judged, every man according to his works. Examine yourself. Forget your neighbor right now. Forget the person sitting next to you right now. Think about you. What works are you working? Is it pleasing to Almighty God? So God ain't judging husband for wife and wife for husband and parents for children. And all. Everybody had an answer for themselves. He went on to say, and death and the grave was cast into the lake of fire, which is the second death. That brings me to the point. When we tell people, repent and be baptized and you'll be saved, it's from the second death. You see, the first death have no power over a person who give the life to God. Why? Because God has power over life and death. And as I would say before, I say again, that's why when Jesus, he walks into the cemetery and he told the people, his good friend Lazarus was dead, and he said, roll back the stone. And they said, no, Lord. He dead 4 days. He will be stinking now. And Jesus started to cry. He wasn't crying because Lazarus was dead. Because he knew he was going to call back Lazarus. That wasn't the problem. You know what the problem was? The problem was the hardness of people's heart. We're wicked. And he's saying, except you repent and go God's way, you will be lost. And I am the one who have power over life and death, and all the doubt in me. So if you don't believe in me, you don't have a chance. Because nobody can call you back from the grave but me. Huh? And they roll back the stone. And he said, Lazarus, come forth. But he ain't come fifth, eh? He come one time. But you know what? The question remains. If Jesus had only make a miss and say, come forth, the whole cemetery that get up. Because he is the resurrection and the life. But that wasn't the regeneration. He wasn't doing that. He just demonstrated his power over life and death. This evening, God has power over our lives. But the choice is still ours. If God takes away the power of choice, that makes you a robot. He don't want robots to serve him. Else he could have made robots. If we could. He wants you to choose. People, we human beings, we generally are not nice. Most of we ain't good, including me. Right? Because of sin. But God take our place for sin. That's why he died. Take our place for sin. Because we should have been there. And we now become his righteousness if we accept it. But nobody, you see, faith is not transferable. What I mean by that? Remember the story of the 10 virgins? 5 was wise and 5 was foolish. Huh? Well, let me tell you about it. Written in the book of Luke. What happened is that you have to prepare a long time for the bridegroom to come. Huh? So the brides are there. And it has no electricity. You have oil in your lamp. So it coming around 12 o'clock. When it's 9 o'clock, some people light burning bright because they have enough oil. But some people really care. They have a little bit of oil in the lamp. And when they start to wicker, say, here now, give me some of yours now. Say, no. No, they're not selfish. What the story is saying is lack of preparation. They said, no, you go in the parlor and buy. When they run in the parlor and buy, time pass and the bridegroom come and gone and they get leave out. You see, the oil represents faith. You can't transfer faith. So I can't feel sorry for you and give some of my faith so God will save you. We all have to obey God for ourselves. And the world will be a better place when we start to do that. Because if you're waiting for your friends and neighbors to get nice, you'll have none. As I speak, and I hope it's not nobody in the building here, there are lots of people who have no friends. You know why? Everybody who offend them, they cut them off. And that is everybody in the world. So they sit by themselves and they're lonely because there's nobody who good enough. You have to forgive people. You have to let go. You have to cry. Let go. But we don't want to do that. When you say sorry, I will forgive you. When that happening? You know what the scripture reads? The scripture reads, while we were yet in our sins, what happened? Christ died for us. Were we saying sorry? No. But you know that ain't going to happen because of we get the nature we born with get corrupted. We are not how God made us. And to be how God make us, we have to now give him back our life. And listen to his word and transform and live right. But we're not doing that. So what we have? Nearly everybody ain't talking to everybody in the world. So it must have war. So today, Kerry is saying to all of us, are you getting ready to come home? Are you getting ready to come home? Well, as you think about it, let's sing song on your sheet. I think everybody should have one. The first song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And I want you to consider the words when you're singing it and realize who Jesus is. He's not a friend who's there to get vexed and drop you. And when you have money, you see him. And when you have, you see him again and so on. You're a good friend. So let's sing together. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, that help, man, oh my. What, oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pains we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Listen to this verse. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? Everywhere. We should never be discouraged. Right, so the family, take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful? Who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Question. Are we weak and heavenly laden? Cumbered with a load of care? Precious Savior, still our refuge. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Oh yes, do thy friend despite forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou will find a solace there. I want us to turn to two scriptures, and you would have heard the message for this evening. And that is 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. So if you have your tab or whatever, I'll wait for you to get there. And we'll read from verse 20. Because we need to understand a little bit about this thing that is called death. That's a little bit. It says there, but now is Christ risen from the dead. It says, and being the first fruit of them who sleep, those who die. He said, for as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all will be made alive. Well, yes, we have good hope. We have to hang into Jesus. But every man in his own order, Christ the first fruit, after they that are Christ at the coming. We got to be in Christ. We all will die, but do not die anywhere else but in Christ. Huh? Because nobody could call you back but Christ. You will die, but make sure that you give your life to the Lord before you leave this land. Die in Christ. He says, then come at the end, when he shall deliver the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. Oh yes, all these nations feel the big and bad. But that time is coming soon, when all that will come crashing down. He said, for he must reign, oh yes, till he put all enemies under his foot. The last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. For he had put all things under his feet. But when he said, all things are put under him, it is made manifest that he is expected, which did put all things under him. So, God, through Christ, is coming back to reign, and he's coming for his people. But it's your choice, where you want to be. And the final reading, I'll take it from 1 Thessalonians. Let me make sure, yes. 1 Thessalonians chapter is 4. And I want the family to pay particular attention to this, because this is where your hope lies. First, we read from verse 13. Hear what the scripture says. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, it shouldn't be if, you should believe. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which sleep in Jesus, God will bring with him. You have to die in Christ. You're going to come back, but you have to die in Christ. Nowhere else. He says, for this we say to you, by the word of Almighty God, not my word. You know what I'm saying to you? He says, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent those who have died. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. You'll just see people passing, you're going up the road. Huh? Then we which are alive and shall remain will be caught up together with him in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore then, comfort one another with these words. Our only comfort for death is that Christ lives and he reigns. And if we're in him one day, we're going to see again each other. I have no fear. Death is just like somebody going in the States for 10, 20 years. And when they come back up in the airport, waiting, oh God, jump up, hug up. Oh yes, we see one another again. So we, today bittersweet. Because we are sad. We're going to miss the fellowship. We will miss the time spent together. All the joys. But the sweet thing is, if we die in the Lord, we will meet again. So there's nothing to worry about. Alright? So let's all stand. And we will sing Precious Lord. After that, we will do the committal and we will have a viewing for all those who would like to come and view. So we can stand by the funeral agency. Right, so you all have to help me with this one. My voice kind of gone with talking without the mic, right? Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I'm tired, I'm weak, I'm lost. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, Precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows deep, Precious Lord, linger near. When my light is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand, Precious Lord, lead me home. When the darkness appears and the night draws near, and the day is past and gone, at the river I stand, guide my feet. Okay. Before we pray and invite people to view, O merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, in whom whosoever believes shall live, though he dies, and whosoever live and believe on him, he shall live again and not die eternally. Who also has taught us by his holy apostle St. Paul, not to be sorry, as men without hope. For those who sleep in him, we humbly beseech thee, Almighty God and Father, to raise us from death of sin unto life of righteousness, that when we shall depart this life, we may rest in him, and that at the resurrection in the last day, we may be found acceptable in thy sight and receive thy blessings, which day which our beloved shall hear and you will pronounce, and Come, you blessed children of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. For as much as it has pleased Almighty God to take our brother Kerry from our life and to take his soul with us departed, we today bear his body to the place where it was made for it, that ashes may return to ashes and dust to dust, and the imperishable spirit return to you, O Lord. Amen. Pray with me, please. O God, O Father in heaven, we come before you in the name of your great Son and King, Jesus Christ, who is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Father, we come praising your name, for you understand all things. There's so much we don't understand, Lord, but we know you understand. And so we commit our lives to you today. We ask, O God, even as we consider our brother who have departed, that we will prepare to meet you one day. Help us to search out the scripture, find the truth, and obey it, so that we too can hear, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into the joys I prepared for you. Father, we love you, we adore you, and today we ask that your blessing go with the family, go with the wife and the children, that they be comforted by your words, so that they can know, oh God, that there's still hope and much to live for because Jesus lives. We thank you in no other name, but the name of our King, our Savior, Jesus Christ, with thanksgiving. Let us all say, amen. Amen. We want to invite...
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head.
Honey?
That's not. I can do it. I can do it.
You sure?
I can do it. Kerry Anthony Devon Williams was a beloved son, brother, and a devoted father of three. Passed away 23rd September 2023. He brought bundles of love and joy and kindness into the lives of those around him. Throughout his life, Kerry was known for his warm smile and his infectious laugh. He had an extraordinary ability to find happiness in even the simplest moments, spreading positivity to everyone fortunate enough to know him. As a father, he poured his heart and soul into nurturing his three children, imparting the values of love, compassion, and resilience. His legacy lives on through the love and strength he instilled in them. Kerry was not just a good guy, he was a remarkable human being who touched the hearts of all who crossed his path. His memory will forever shine brightly in our hearts. Funny story. When I was having my daughter, first Kerry was excited. Kerry leave the phone, run down the road all the way to phase two to call Gerard and Corey to say, I am in labor. It was so funny. So poor B now had to be the clear-minded one to call them and say, look, Kerry coming, it's time. He was so excited. He was a gifted cook and bartender. Those were his passions. He was also good at talking nonsense and making you laugh. And as his son would say, no more stale jokes. I will never hear him call me a pint again. May Kerry rest in peace, knowing that his love and kindness will continue to inspire and lift us all. Thank you.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. Cause all my
each and every one of us here have to answer, right? And as they say, when in death you're supposed to be rejoicing because that individual has already lived the life, and is when a child born, you cry, you weep, because you don't know the life that a child is coming into, right? I want to take this time on behalf of my family to tell Val and her husband and family, and he saw her brothers, sisters, everybody, he has gone to a better place where he's not feeling any hurt or anything anymore. So let us just rejoice and remember Kerry for the person that we know him to be, because he has always been a part of our family and he will always be a part of our family. All right, thank you.
Amen. Come.
Get up. Get up. Get up.
Hi, my name is Cadence Williams, and I am the child of Kerry Williams. So I want to say everything, the good memories that me and my father had. Every day we always used to walk to school. We always had a fun time going to school. When we come back from school, we would always talk about our day, and we would always do whatever we wanted. When we came back home, we always washed our hands and played together. I always used to love my dad when he was alive.
Okay. All right, on the 28th of July, I was hospitalized. I started to feel ill and I drove myself to the hospital. So I got to Mongtop, and not being staff, I decided to go through it like everybody else. So while sitting on a chair, I'm looking down the corridor, but I seen somebody I know. I said, "Boy, why does it look like Kerry?" I sat down on the chair like he spot me too. So I said, "Okay, Kerry, come. What you doing here?" I said, what you doing here? He said, sometimes he call me Abby, sometimes Auntie Abigail. I'm here 3 days now. He said, but I come to see how you going. So this is me in my mind. He is not well, and he asking me how I going. But you know, that night, you know what I did? We sat close to each other, and we both slept on the chair whole night till next morning. I did all my tests. I was okay, but apparently he wasn't. But he said, you know what? You go ahead. Be good. Eh? And I said, okay. And he said, don't forget to bring back something for me. And that's what I remember him. Your son was a wonderful, your brother was a wonderful person. I have known this child since 10 years of age, and he has always been respectable. He always told me what was going on. And son, rest in peace.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else? Feel free. Time is of essence. Let's go.
My brother was a very loving and caring person. Even though we might have our differences in certain talks and stuff like that, he always made you laugh. Whatever the situation was, you could tell Kerry some serious now. 2 minutes, he's saying some nonsense or doing something to for you to remember him by and making you laugh. You'd be like, Kerry, I know, tell you some serious. Well, that now personal. What is he hold back? We had a laugh. You understand? He was. He'll be missed very dearly. I love him very much. Despite what we have been through, he has been there for me. I've been there for him. Hope in spirit and as a soul, he will keep us up and keep moving forward no matter what. Right? So. You all just keep carrying all your memories. No matter what you all have been through, he will always love you all, no matter what. And be safe. And amen. Amen.
Suspended in school, I was frightened and I didn't know what to do. I wasn't calling my mother because she would have beat me. And I called Daddy Kerry. I said, Daddy Kerry, I don't get suspended, but I don't know what to do. And you know, he said, don't worry, I will come. And he come and he said, don't worry, I go talk to Shifa and I go make sure. And then he said, you go by your grandparents and spend the week and relax yourself. You know, despite everything. If you call him and you say, well, I'm in a tough situation or in a pickle, he would have been there for you. So that is one of the things I want to remember about him. Thanks.
Okay, we're going once.
I love my son. Not one day I ever had trouble with him. Kerry never bring trouble by me once. Fantastic human. Great sense of humor. I beg him to fight. I said, Kerry, fight. Let's have life. He sure it is. fight. It's ready. I'm glad you see the world. Selfless. I love him. Great smile.
From he moved to Kelly Village a couple years ago. So we have a business front, and the first time I met him, he came to the store all weird with these flamboyant colors and beads. He loved beads, and he would just be like, hello, and I was like, who's this weird dude trying to talk to me? But it started and it grew into a relationship of not just friend, but family. And he was supportive to me in a time of my life where I was at my lowest and very insecure where my health was concerned, even when I didn't even know he had his issues happening. And every day he would be there as a support, you know. And what he brought to our lives, everyone that he touched in my family, is the fact that no matter the circumstance, he taught us to embrace who we were and be thankful for life and love one another despite of the differences that we might have or the challenges that we may have. That was what he represented. He was life, he was love, he was joy, he was color. He was about family and sharing and giving. And I missed him even before he, when he moved, I missed him. And I don't even know how to say it. It's a void that won't be filled in terms of just a friend. He became family to me, and I hope all his family and his wife's family and his bird family could understand what he truly represented. Wasn't just about blood, it was about spirit and heart. Thank you.
Okay, at this time we want to start.
Kerry worked with Innovative Pest Control, and as a pest control technician, he was stationed at National Flour Mills. So he was like a member of the NFM family. And all that was said here this evening is really true about Kerry. And as on behalf of National Flour Mills, I'd like to accept my condolences to his family, and he will be missed. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. So at this time, we'll ask the funeral home to come and open up.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me.
Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up.
For your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing.
Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up.
Get up. Long as my heart beating and I'm breathing air, I fight for me. What a sight. Anytime, anywhere. And I will never back down from it. That's not coming, I just attack from the front. And don't ask questions and nothing, do you hear? Yeah. Yeah. Oh no, I can't stop now. I gave him my all and it still ain't enough. Everybody getting knocked down. The only thing that matters what you gon' do when you get up. Get up there. Get up now. Get up there. Get up. The only thing that matters what you gon' do when you get up. No matter what you're gonna do when you get up. Get up. Get up. Only thing no matter what you're gonna do.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night you are close like no other. I've known you as a father.
Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up.
Get up. Long as my heart beating and I'm breathing air, I fight for me. What a sight. Anytime, anywhere. And I will never back down from it. That's not coming, I just attack from the front. And don't ask questions or nothing, do you hear? Yeah. Yeah. Oh no, I can't stop now. I gave him my all and it still ain't enough. Everybody getting knocked down. The only thing that matters what you gon' do when you get up. Get up there. Get up now. Get up there. Get up. The only thing that matters what you gon' do when you get up. No matter what you gon' do when you get up. Get up. Get up. Only thing no matter get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Get up. Long as my heart beating and I'm breathing air, I fight for me. What a sight. Anytime, anywhere. And I will never back down from it. That's not coming, I just attack from the front. And don't ask questions or nothing, do you hear?